Thank you. It's a privilege to introduce one of my mentors and teachers, Dr. Filsoufi, who is one of the senior members of the faculty here. I'm sure almost everyone knows him. I think other than Dr. Nguyen, he's probably going to be the next in line, him and Dr. Adams, in terms of the number of time at Mount Sinai. He trained in France under Professor Carpentier, and he was one of Carpentier's most eminent students, and has gone on to be one of Carpentier's closest associates. He co-wrote the Carpentier's Valve Reconstructive Surgery with Dr. Carpentier and Dr. Adams. His interests are very diverse and are mainly mitral valve surgery. He's published very widely in all areas of cardiac surgery. He's mentored a lot of trainees, myself included. But here he's going to talk about one of his other interests, which is in medical history. As he's probably going to share with you, he has a very diverse collection of very old medical works, and he's brought some of them here with him. So he's going to tell us a bit about, I believe, the history of valve surgery. Dr. Filsoufi.
Thank you very much, Annie. I appreciate that. Good morning to all of you. I think Annie used the right word. It is an interest of mine. I'm not a historian of medicine, and I'm not a historian, I have a great interest in the history of cardiovascular medicine, and it's close to be a passion. So I'm here this morning to share more a passion with you rather than, giving you a lecture on history. So the talk initially was oriented more toward the valvular heart disease, but as Dr. Adams is not here, he asked me to displace the focus, which is not bad because it brings us a little bit earlier and to the anatomy of the heart from a structural point of view and from functional point of view. And it takes us just to the introduction of valvular heart disease. Hopefully we will do that in the near future. So one of the things that first you want to know when you talk about history is what are your sources? Who said this is a historical document and this is not a historical document? So there are multiple bibliography references. They are from, for example, collection of William Osler, who has one of the greatest collection of antiquarian books. There is one called Welcome. But the Bible of medical bibliography is Garrison Morton, which was published in 1943. It's two American historians and physicians that put their work together for over several decades and published this bibliography, which goes back to the antiquarian Greek medicine and has references in different areas of medicine. So it has in anatomy, it has in cardiovascular medicine, it has in ophthalmology, and so forth. The fifth edition was made by one of my best friends, Jeremy Norman, in 1991. But as the knowledge has expanded exponentially in the 20th century, it's extremely difficult now to say for a historian or for a physician what is historical, for example, compared to work that was done three decades or four decades ago. So in the near future, most of the bibliography references eventually will be done by subspecialists. And a lot of things that are true maybe in 20 years will not be true. So it's very difficult to do a sixth edition of this book. But at least the first five editions are very relevant, although there are mistakes into them and some of the historical documents have been missed. But this is the reference in the business of history of medicine, if you like to look at the references. So I don't have any disclosure. So for us, in order to understand what we know now, and it's fun. It's a little bit annoying, but we got to go through that for 4 or 5 minutes. But for those of you who don't know, it's actually what we know today, or what the science that went to the European Renaissance come from Greek medicine more than 1,400 years ago. And the bulk of knowledge is the work of Galen, who did a lot of dissections of monkeys and pigs. And he described the blood motion in a particular way. And at that time, a lot of the knowledge also were based also on cosmology, myth, and a lot of superstitions. So they describe, at least Galen described, three what we called spirit. One was the natural spirit, which was synthesized in the liver. What was the vital spirit, which was synthesized in the heart, and what was the animal spirit, which was made in the brain. So the concept of blood motion at that time was the food was ingested in the intestines, was transferred through the portal system to the liver. And in the liver, the blood was synthesized, and with the mixture, you had the natural spirit, which was the source of nutrition. And the natural spirit through the venous system was brought to the entire body. So we were living through the natural spirit, which was providing nutrition to the body. And the liver was the center of basically venous system at that time. And a part of the blood through the vena cava was brought to the right ventricle. And a significant amount of the blood was expelled through the right ventricle pulmonary artery. And through the breathing, the impurities was expelled. But he described a small pores in the septum, and a significant or small amount of the blood was driven from the right ventricle to the left ventricle, and the air was coming from the pulmonary veins through the left atrium and the mitral valve, and the mixture of the blood from the right ventricle and the air from the left side was forming the vital spirit. And the vital spirit was driven to convey to the entire body through the arterial system. And again, you have the animal spirit, which was the seed of the soul, and the animal spirit was conveyed to the body through the nervous system. So according to this system, there was this hole that allows for the blood to go from the right ventricle to the left ventricle. And you also describe some relative incompetency of the valves, because all the blood motion in the venous system and the arterial system was an ebb and flow system. It's a up and down, back and forth motion of the blood. So that's important, because what Galen said was believed to be the Bible of medicine. His beliefs was indisputable, and he was inspired by the word of God. So that is the knowledge that came to the European Renaissance. But interestingly, this knowledge which came to the European Renaissance actually came through, this shows you some of the dissections that Galen did, mostly based on pigs and on monkeys. So most of this knowledge that came to the European Renaissance came actually to the from the Islamic age, and from the work of Persian and Arabic physicians. And a lot of their works in the medieval age was translated from Arabic to Latin and Greek. So there are a lot of mistakes, and a lot of people who translate their works, they're adjusted to their amount of work or translated in their own ways. So there are a lot of mistakes, and you have a lot of different versions of what has been translated and transported over time. Another teaching of Galen was that the heart is a two-chamber structure, right ventricle as we discussed, and the left ventricle. So the right atrium was considered an extension of the vena cava system, and the left atrium was considered an extension of the pulmonary veins extension. This is one of the illustration of the heart, which is contributed to the work of Avicenna. And he was a famous Persian physician who described some work about the pulse and the fever. But what is interesting, he also described the heart. He believed in the Galenic teaching as a two-chamber structure, with the right ventricle and the left ventricle. And these dots, they correspond to the valves of the heart. With the image of the mirror, you have the tricuspid valve with three leaflets. You have the mitral valve, the aortic valve, and the pulmonic valve. What is interesting is that the heart that you see on Valentine's Day, this shape that goes for 100 years, has come from this inspiration, that the heart is a two-chamber structure. So these are some of the work that were done during the Islamic age. And as you can see, they also believe in the Galenic teaching with the arterial system, as you can see here. Very minimal detail in the description of the heart or the thoracic structures, and the venous system, as you can see here. A little bit more detail in terms of presentation of the abdominal organs. the same thing, a little bit the arterial system exposed. These are all the drawings that goes back to the around 15th century. Now, once we get to the end of the medieval age and to the early episodes of the European Renaissance that start about 1450, here you have the expansion of the anatomical knowledge. And this is basically the first isolated book on anatomy. It was done by Mondino de Luzzi, who lived from 1275 to 1326 and died. And this publication is from 1478. So what is important is that when you look at the antiquarian book, they all have a title page with the title of the book, and you have what we call a centerpiece, a frontispiece. And the frontispiece, according to the time in the history, they have significant or less relevance. And here, you have the professor of anatomy reading the teaching of Galen, and these are barber surgeons. At that time, the surgeons were mostly barber. So because most what they have to do was amputation. And he is doing the dissection. And basically, the teaching was going from generation to generation by the professor who was basically spreading the teaching of Galen without any observation. And again, the book of De Luzzi doesn't have any medical illustration, but it is, from historical point of view, the first book of anatomy. The second book that has relevance from historical point of view is the book of Ketam. This is the first anatomic book with medical illustration. And as you can see, a lot of these authors, although they are respected from historical point of view, they have been accused of plagiarism. There is a significant similarity between the frontispiece of this book and the previous book. You have the professor sitting up there giving the lecture, and you have the barber surgeon doing the dissection. And from that point of view, you are going to see from the beginning of the writing in medicine, there's a lot of accusation of plagiarism and cheating, basically. And this book has about 25 woodcut engraving. And for example, these are two of them. One which shows some of the abdominal organs or urogenital organs with an external view, and the other one on the right side which has more illustrations from internal organs, and you see the shape of the heart, again, two-chamber structure with the septum at the middle and the large vessel coming out of the heart. This book called Fasciculus Medicini was published in 1491. But keep that in mind here, we are already, you know, 40 years down in the Renaissance, and the quality of the medical illustration, which are quite basics. Although from art point of view and the painting, there are, you know, magnificent painting during that time, but from medical point of view, you can see that the illustrations remain very basic. So if you look, some other books that have been published, some of them are not only about medicine, but they can be also about philosophy with some introduction to the medicine. This is a publication from 1499 from Palik that shows again the heart as a two structure with the septum at the middle. And you can see the large vessels coming and going out of the heart, and you have the pericardium around it. Again, the previous was 1491, this is 1499. Okay, after Palik, you have the work of Magnus Hunt. And what I'm showing to you, this is a comprehensive view of what has been published as an illustration on the heart. There's nothing missing here. I mean, it really goes chronologically from, you know, 1491 to 99. And now this is we are in 1500-01. And again, illustration of the heart, which is a two-chamber structure with the septum at the middle. So here is the big jump, and it doesn't require any explanation, and you can see it by yourself. Here is the work of Leonardo da Vinci, the biggest genius of the European Renaissance. And look at the quality of the drawing compared to the previous images that you have seen. And There are both. Now, what is interesting about Da Vinci, as you know, he was an artist, was a painter, he was an architect, he was an engineer, and he has a lot of interest in a lot of areas. He dissected himself about 30 human bodies, because at the time of European Renaissance, the Roman Catholic Church removed a lot of restrictions on dissections. So a lot of physicians or artists like himself were authorized to do dissections, or they were doing that illegally. And so Vesalius, who went to Paris, was getting a lot of the body from criminals who from the jails when they were dead, or from patients who died in the hospitals where they didn't have any families. Yeah. So the work of Da Vinci is very interesting because they were not known at that time. So his knowledge actually didn't impact the progress of medicine. A lot of his medical illustrations were held by his family members or his pupils, and they were all got together, at least most of them, in the 18th century by John Hunter. But what is interesting is to see also the evolution of his understanding of the anatomy of the heart, although he didn't also describe the circulation, and he believed in what Galen was saying in terms of the motion of the blood. But where are his contributions is, again, the exactitude of his drawing. And here is one of his first internal, you know, view of the heart. You see these little dots here. These are the little pores that he described, or he agreed with Galen that there was little pores in the septum with the motion of the blood from right to left. Here you can see the some of his work in terms of thoracic organs, and this view of the trachea with the bronchial distributions. So one of the credit that Leonardo da Vinci gets is he's probably one of the first authors to describe the heart as a four-chamber structure. Now, these are very important. We just said as one word, but what he was saying is against the belief of Galen. And as we said, that was the Bible of medicine. So going against what was the Galenic teaching was a big deal in that time and that period. But again, at that time, his work wasn't known. His work was known almost two centuries later. But even in this drawing, although the heart is depicted as a four-chamber structure, you see these little dots in the septum and following the Galenic teaching. These are some of the posterior views of the heart with the distribution of the coronary arteries. You can see the distribution of the right coronary artery on the right bottom pictures. Here you have on the top right, again, a posterior view of the right coronary distribution. On the bottom right, you see some images of the aortic valve. This is the description of the bronchial circulation by Da Vinci. This is a cross-section of the heart. And you can see at the middle, the cross-section of the heart with the two ventricles in the systole. And on the bottom is a cross-section longitudinal view of the heart, the right ventricle and the left ventricle. This is what is known as a description on the top left, the moderator band on the right ventricle. And what is a little bit more interesting is there this arch view of the mitral valve, the opening and closing images of the mitral valve, as you can see, understood the existence of the commissures and the proximity to the aortic valve. So there is a work of Frank Wells. He's a very eminent British surgeon. He's a heart surgeon with the world-recognized expertise in Da Vinci's work. And he does a lot of mitral valve repair, I think, in Papworth. So he published about 3 years ago a large and nice book about the anatomic drawings with a lot of explanation on the work of Da Vinci. And I recommend it to you. It's a really nice book. And these are some of the drawings of the Da Vinci about the aortic root and the movement of vortices in the sinuses of Valsalva. And again, the semilunar shape of the aortic cusps. in the opening and closing positions. And that's probably the first illustration of an aortic valve with four cusps. So what is important, again, this revolutionary work at that time wasn't recognized, and it was recognized about 200 years later when John Hunter got all his works together. None of the work of Da Vinci were published until 1915, and about 150 of his medical illustrations were published in 1915. There was another edition, I think, in the 1940s, which has about 200 of them. But the entire work, body of his anatomical work, was published in 1981. They're right now at the Queen Elizabeth Collection. Queen Elizabeth Library has all the anatomical work of Da Vinci. And actually, our friend Frank Wells is very close to Prince Charles. That's why he has access to all the original and could do a nice work. But in 1981, Queen Elizabeth agreed to have published in 1,500 examples, in facsimile, the entire body of anatomical work of Da Vinci. So you have one example over there. This is in, actually, the text is in German. The drawings are the same. If you'd like to look at it at the end, you're welcome. Here, this is the work of Bartolomeo Eustachi. He's one of the anatomists of the European Renaissance. The same thing, most of his work were not known, and they were buried in the Papal Library, and they were published in 1714. But most of his work were done around 1550, 1560. And here you have six drawings of the heart, and the top two are external view of the heart. The figure three is a cross-section of the tricuspid valve with the right ventricle. And on the bottom, you have the figure six is the cross-section of the mitral valve with the subvalvular apparatus, the view of the left ventricle with the trabeculations. And here, you have a higher cross-section with the shape of the aortic valves and the connection to the left ventricle. As you can see, again, they were done at the same time that the drawing of the Da Vinci, and you can see the difference in the quality of the work done by one author compared to the other one. And this is another book which is very well respected by Brangario di Capri, which was published in 1522. And here you can see a cross-section of the left ventricle with the three cusps of the aortic valve. You see the ascending aorta. And interestingly, it divides into two branches in this illustration, with the arch, which is diverted to the right side. And as you can see, the descending thoracic aorta is also on the right side. And these are additional view in his anatomic work, with, again, cross-sections of the left ventricle with the three cusps of the aortic valve on the top. On the upper right, you have a cross-section toward the apex. You can see the two leaflets of the mitral valve with the subvalvular apparatus. You can see they are very rudimentary illustrations and coronary distribution on the lower right side. But again, most of these authors provide a structural description of the anatomy of the heart, and none of them describe the functional anatomy of the heart, and they all agree with what was the description of the blood motion by Galen. And here comes the man that revolutionized the history of medicine as you know it, because this is the first author really who started the modern era of medicine from the European Renaissance, considering that the work of Galen, the work of Da Vinci, wasn't known. You guys, have you heard about him or no? You don't know? Of course you know. But what do you know, Bert, what was his contribution to medicine?
No, I do not.
You don't know, okay. Vesalius, in one word, is the father of descriptive anatomy. Okay, this guy at the age of 18, he was born in Brussels. He goes to France to study medicine. And he works with a guy called Sylvius, who was one of the biggest believers in the Galenic teaching. And once he finishes his studies in France, comes back to Belgium and starts doing a lot of dissections. And he first published a book with his friends about anatomy, but it's more about osteology and the muscular system. And in 1543, he publishes this book, which is called De Humani Corporis Fabrica, on the structure of human body. And the illustration of this book was done by Juan Calcar, which was the pupil of Titian, one of the biggest painter of the European Renaissance. And this book is there. You can look at the medical illustration. They are magnificent, particularly whenever it comes to the bone and the muscle. They are completely another level of expertise and exactitude and precision. And he's the first author that really divide the anatomy in different sections. Thoracic organ, abdominal organ, osteology, and muscular system, and vascular system. And this is the cover of his book. This is the frontispiece of his book. And this is himself doing the dissection with the barber surgeon hiding below the table. So there is a meaning. This is the most famous frontispiece in the history of medicine. And if you compare the two books that I showed you, this is the first book in the history of about anatomy. And you have the professor doing the dissection and the barber doing the lecture and the barber doing the dissection. And here you have the frontispiece of Vesalius, where the professor is doing the dissection and the barber surgeon basically are hiding and not playing any role. And at that time, you have all the anatomical theater that were open in Europe, and lay people, physicians, and anybody could pay a fee and go and watch these dissections. And it was very common, you know, for families to go with kids, because some of the illustrations have also kids hanging around and playing. And as you mentioned, a lot of these dissections were done by dissecting the body of criminals or people who died who didn't have any family. And he was so good that when he was blindfolded and you were giving him a piece of bone, he could give you the name of the bone. So that was his expertise, was among the greatest in Europe. But what is his main contribution is not the quality of the quality of his drawing, is that you should describe what you observe. He's the founder of the science of observation rather than to believe in what you have been told. So the main contribution of Vesalius is that in the first edition of his book in 1543, he put in doubt the existence of the pores in the septum. And in 1555, he basically rejected the existence of the pores in the in the septum. So he basically is the first author who openly, publicly went against the teaching of Galen and said the blood motion, as he didn't go against his blood motion. He just said there's no hole, and what he is saying, I cannot prove it. So that was at that time a revolutionary comment. Even today, if you say something, you may lose your job, but at that time, they could kill you. So that's his main contribution, is that he went against Galenic teaching and opened the era for the science of observation and anatomic description. So he's the father of what we call descriptive anatomy. And his book was first published in 1543. The second edition is 1555. And I just put there are about 277 woodcut engraving. I put the section 6, which is about cardiovascular system. And again, if you look at this medical illustration, compared to what was before from Berengario or Eustachy, you see a huge difference in terms of quality of and detail in terms of precision. Again, some of these are very well known, but again, we get to the heart. And here you have, again, the detailed structure of the anatomical description of the heart with the left ventricle and right ventricle with the tricuspid valve. And there are significantly more detail. Basically, this book was a reference anatomical book for 200 years. And the next book, this is again 1543, that came with more detailed anatomical description of the heart is from Sinai in 1748. So almost for 200 years, that was the reference book in anatomy. Again, the right ventricle with the pulmonic valve, the left ventricle with the mitral valve, and you can see the anterior and the posterior leaflet. You see the subvalvular apparatus, you see the two papillary muscles, and the left ventricle and the sigmoid shape of the aortic valve and the attachment of the aortic valve. The cross-section of the heart. There are about 10 illustrations about the heart in this book. And once he did his work and he questioned the existence of the pores in the septum, Vesalius made a lot of enemies, particularly among his pupils. And he was forced to leave the academic world and went to the court of Charles I in Spain. He became a court physician. And his pupil actually took his job. And here is Realdo Colombo. Colombo had also a book, which I'm showing it to you over there, which was published in 1559, 6 months after he died. So he wanted to be in competition with his mentor, because at that time when they fired Vesalius and they put him at his place, he wanted to do a better job. So he said, I'm going to do the better anatomical work. And he wanted the drawing to be done by Michelangelo. So for a few years, he left Padua to go to Rome to work with Michelangelo. But a couple of years after they started their collaboration, Michelangelo died. And he couldn't put anatomical illustration in his book. And his book became a smaller book with no medical illustration and was published 6 months after. This is the book of Vesalius, this is the book of Colombo. So Colombo has very significant contribution, but he's also been accused of plagiarism. And the first plagiarism is the cover of his book. Because he's showing that's himself, Colombo dissecting a human body, exactly the same thing that Vesalius was doing. So there is a lack of originality here that have raised a lot of criticism among the historians of art and medicine. The second thing is his main contribution is, what is his main contribution? Anyone of you guys know? Okay. His main contribution is that he described the pulmonary circulation. And he did a lot of vivisections, and his book has 15 chapters, and one chapter is about the viva sezione. So he did a lot of animal dissections when they were alive. And what was, if you do dissection animal who are alive, what can you observe in the left atrium?
No, you see that left atrium control.
So what you see is that, according to Galenic teaching, air was coming through the pulmonary veins, through the left atrium, and going through the left ventricle. So what he observed is that there is no air in the left atrium. So that was the second piece of puzzle going against a Galenic teaching. So although initially he was against his mentor, saying, you know, you shouldn't go against Galen and by saying there's no holes in the septum. But when he started doing his own experimental work, he saw there is no air going from pulmonary veins to the left atrium. So And he described the fact that the blood goes through the right ventricle, through the pulmonary artery, to the lungs, and it's blood that comes back to the pulmonary veins to the left atrium. And the other contribution that he has, he's the first one who described precisely that the blood goes in one direction in the valves of the heart. So this relative incompetency of the valve, which was described by Galen, was completely disproved by him. So these are his two contributions. Now, why is he accused of plagiarism? Because there is an Arab physician, Ibn Nafis, on the 13th century, who described the pulmonary circulation too. And he said there is no air in the left atrium, although his descriptions are not very detailed. And there is another book, it's a theological book by Michel Servet, which was published in 1555, 4 years before him, that said there is no air going through the left atrium, and the mix between the air and the blood is done in the lungs. But this is a theological book, it's not a scientific book. So, but the historian believes that Colombo didn't have access to this material. Because when Michel Servetus published his book in 1555, he was killed because his beliefs are against the religion, and most of his books were burned. So, and they believe that Colombo didn't have access to the Arabic material to translate them. So from historical point of view, at least in Western culture, he's the guy who described the pulmonary circulation. But from overall historical point of view, that can be eventually questioned. And here comes the next author. Most of these guys, they were all at Padua University. Padua, I'm sure you all know, is very close to Venice. And that time was the center of knowledge in Europe. And a significant number of professors at that time, as the chair of anatomy or medicine, they were actually selected by the students. So after Colombo, the guy who took over was Fabrizi. And his major publication is this one, called De Venarum Osteolis, which was published in 1603. And he's the first guy who observed the existence of the valves inside the veins. And this is also a very famous medical illustration with the ligation of the arm up there. And a more detailed description, these are these valves that he saw in the venous system. But he didn't understand the meaning of these valves and what they are doing. So here is his observations on the valves. Again, if you remember, according to the Galenic teaching, the blood was sanitized through the liver and was directed, conveyed to the body through the venous system, right? So here is his observation. In my opinion, these valves are formed that they maybe to a certain extent delay the blood and so prevent the whole of it flowing to the feet, the hands, and, or the fingers and collecting there. So basically, he described the valves as a like a barrier to decelerate the motion of the blood toward the extremities. Otherwise, they would go too fast and they would accumulate in your fingers and in your hands. And that's one thing I wanted to show you, because if you have an interest about the old books and antiquarian books, this is what called original cover. This is from 1600. This book and this is was edited as a print in a small manuscript. It's a 4-page document. It doesn't exist anymore because the paper. The document that has it is his Opera Omnia, its entire work, which was published in 1628. And this is an original cover from 1628. And it's called Uncut. You see the edges are completely irregular. So you have all these drawings inside if you are interested in looking at them. And he was also professor at Padua. And when he retired, his pupil took over, and his pupil is the most famous physician in the history of medicine, and is William Harvey. And William Harvey went to med school, I think initially in England, but he went after to Padua to finish his study at Padua. And his really magnus opus, his most important work, is Domotu Cordis, because he's the one who described the blood circulations and opened the era of what we call experimental physiology. So what he did is just the making a reflection to his book. It's a small book, actually. It's 72 pages, has 12 chapters. The first section is on the motion of the heart. And the second work is his quantitative analysis and his work on the upper and lower extremities to describe the motion of the blood. And one of his observations was, again, the contraction of the heart during systole and the ejection of the heart through the aorta during the systole. Before him, it was believed that the arteries, they dilate, and the dilatation of the arteries basically suck the substance from the left ventricle to the arterial system. And he's the one who described the contraction of the heart is at the origin of the expelling of the blood to the arterial system. And he's...
So how come earlier on when they were doing these animals, you know, dissections, were they not dissecting live animals mm-hmm. to see the ventricle contracting?
But again, a lot of things that you believe you didn't agree with. You know what I'm saying? A lot of people were just believing on what they were told by Galenic teaching based on the fact that it was divine, you know, message from the God that you cannot go against it. And some of the things that they said, they were not completely... Colombo wasn't too far, but the guy who really described the heart as a pump, that has a pump function, that send blood through the system. If you read the writing, for example, of Harvey, is much more clear than the writing of Colombo. I could have put them, you know, next to each other to see, but one is more focused on the valve inside the heart and the fact that there is no air. More sees the whole system completely differently. And his work is in ligaturing the upper extremity is very important because he shows that if you put his tourniquet on upper extremity, if you put it very tight, the pulse goes away. So showing that in the arterial system, the blood comes toward the periphery. And he also showed that if you put the tourniquet and you don't put it very high, the blood accumulates in the venous system. So his suggestion was the blood goes from the vein toward the heart, which was against the Galenic teaching, which was the blood goes from the liver toward the outside body. So the entirety of his work, also based on quantitative analysis, that's the same thing. I mean, by observation is very easy, but the guy who did the quantitative analysis is him, because he showed that if each heart beating, a certain amount of blood is ejected, how much in a minute, in 30 minutes, an hour, the liver should sanitize blood for a patient to, for somebody to survive. And he concluded that based on what we eat is incompatible. So, I mean, today, fifth grade can probably do it, but at that time, it wasn't that easy. So again, his work, is very significant because he's the one who basically said the blood motion according to Galen doesn't exist and there is a blood circulation is all contained. Although he couldn't see the capillary system, which was discovered by Malpighi in 1661. Okay, so he also, his work raised a lot of questions, a lot of hostilities. And the best publisher in Europe who were in Switzerland or in Italy didn't want to publish his work. His work was published in Germany, in Frankfurt, his first edition of this book. As I said, it's a 72-page book. The bounding is very poor. The quality of the paper is very poor. And it has 248 misspellings, which was very common at that time. But 248 for a 72-page book, it's a lot. And you can find it. I mean, the first edition of this book, which is the most expensive book in terms of history of medicine, you can't find it on the market. It doesn't exist. But you have the second or third edition. But his work is really tremendous because he opened the door to the experimental physiology. And at that time, as the dissections was getting widespread, you have the first introduction of the concept of the disease. And you have the work of John Fernell in 1559 that coined the two terms of physiology and pathology, because based on the dissection, they could observe that the theory of Galen in terms of disease, which I'm not going to go through it, it didn't exist, and that that opened the whole area of anatomopathology. So I'm just going to stop there, because whatever goes to the diseases, I'm going to wait for Dr. Adams to be here. But that was the view that shows you a bit over 1,500. Again, it may appear short, but it's really comprehensive. It includes all the medical illustration in the Western world that focuses on the heart and the thoracic organs that leads to the description of the anatomic structure of the heart in terms of not only structure, but also function with the description of the blood circulation by Harvey. Thank you.